I'm at home. And when I'm watching the races on TV still, I still get the butterflies and I still get the jitters, getting excited to watch the guys compete.
Yeah. And Tyson, that week leading up to the Olympics, and you would have done Olympics on foreign soil outside the USA as well. So, you know, in terms of what it means in terms of transport, arranging accommodation, flights, detail, part of US team, the lead up to the events, the sort of early rounds about pacing yourself, the whole sort of, is it a bit chaotic all the same in terms of, or is it just the normal preparation that you would do for world championships, the normal preparation would you do for Diamond League? Is the whole Olympic thing a different sort of preparation?
I believe it's slightly different because of the preparation mentally. Because you have a whole USA staff, you have medical, you have psychologists, you have doctors, you have everyone there at your, you know, disposal so you can get ready. So mentally, I feel like you have a lot more there to balance. So I think it's a lot tougher to just focus in and lock in because you have so much surrounding you. As far as so many different nations, it's just one of those things where you just have to be able to focus and block out everything. But it's slightly different from Diamond League and getting ready for normal meets.
Yeah, and we know in terms of some countries, in terms of the USA, to make the USA trials is so cutthroat even as it is. But some of those athletes are coming into the Olympic Games off stellar sort of years and they go through these sort of early rounds. But how important is it not to take the early rounds for granted in terms of the preheats when some of the favorites are expected to walk through maybe to the semifinals and stuff like that? But we all know a stumble, a little fall, anything that a slip of the mind, concentration. And if you fall in the first round, you can kiss your dreams goodbye because there is no semifinal. There is no final. So how important is it to zone in, even though you might not think to yourself, these athletes would think to yourself, we're going to sail through these preliminary heats and conserve energy and sort of stuff like that. Is it dangerous all the same?
It's we have to be safe, you know, so it is dangerous if you're cruising too much because you also still want to turn your body on as well as saving some energy. So you have to find a balance when it comes to running the rounds, I believe. And, you know, I think you just have to really stay in tune with your coach, you know, looking at your heat sheet, seeing who's in your heat sheet. So if you have an easier heat, it may be best to take it a little bit easier. But if you have someone in your heat that can run a little bit, it may be best to secure the top spot so you can have a preferred lane going into the next round.
Yeah. And Tyson, I'm going to start now. We're going to bring it to an event that you all know too well, the 100 meters. And people are going into talking about this 100 meters and Noah Lyles is doing an awful talk. He's talking about domination, dominating 100 meters, 200 meters. Some of the pretenders, the reigning champion, like Lamont Marcel Jacobs, very quiet, very sort of low-key sort of a build-up. He is the reigning champ, and dare I say, he's probably, for all the reigning Olympic champions coming in the back of history, he's probably the one least talked about. And does he deserve a bit of recognition for what he did 4 years ago? Because he came from nowhere in terms of winning that Olympic gold medal, is it? But is it wrong for anyone to say, disembark him and say that was a fluke or something like that? And because he earned his gold medal.
Absolutely. I believe he's been overlooked, unfortunately. And I think, you know, he will be the dark horse because he's been kind of quiet this year. But he's with, Rainer, I think, is his coach now. He's with a very good coach who has proven himself that he can produce medalists. So I really truly believe that he can be top three if everything falls into place. I believe a lot of people are sleeping on this guy, but I believe he's going to be the sleeper and he's going to show up ready to defend his title.
Yeah. And the guy who's talking an awful lot, who's backing Noah Lyles and talking him down, is Oblique Seville, the Jamaican guy. He has his psyche, he has his in his building in terms of his confidence that he thinks he's the guy who's going to quiet Noah Lyles. He thinks he's the next Jamaican prodigy in terms of 100 meters. But in Kishari Thompson in as well, we have another contenders, Akine Sembe, Fred Curley, and then maybe the Fernande Omanyala, the African sprinter. So is it very much the 100 meters is more dangerous for Noah Lyles than the 200?
I believe just a little bit. You know, anybody can lose, you know. And Noah, when he's on, he's very hard to beat. But these other guys have shown that they ran pretty fast times as well this year. But with Noah, you know, I truly feel what separates him from the other guys is his mental. I believe he's been here before. I believe he understands what's at stake. I believe he's so confident. I think his confidence pours off on the other competitors as in fear. You know, I believe he talks his way and him showing his confidence. I just think he just bleeds so much confidence. I think that puts fear into the other athletes. That's the thing with Noah. I believe that happens because, like I said, anybody can be beat. But Noah is showing a lot of dominance in an event that is not his favorite event. And that's what's more impressive.
Yeah. And I suppose, Tyson, when you look at that, for a guy who's putting as much effort into the 100 and 200, we see certain athletes are just concentrating on one event. Is there a sort of a fear that if, God forbid, for Noah Lyles, if he finishes, something happens and he finishes with a bronze medal, that that might affect his psyche in terms of the other event, in terms of that, that he didn't... Obviously, athletes have so zoned in that in terms of they think gold, so the elite athletes, it's gold, 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 anything apart from that, they see it as a sort of failure. Is there a sort of fear that if something happened or Noah Lyles got boxed in or something and he wound up with a bronze medal in the 100 that it might affect him at all in the 200?
I don't think nothing's going to affect him in the 200, to be honest. Nothing, nobody. I truly believe that that he's mentally strong enough to handle anything. Now, if he does get bronze in 100, I don't really look at that as a failure, or if he gets silver, you know, but I believe he's going for gold, and whatever happens is going to happen in his opinion. So I think he's going in as the favorite. And I don't think nothing's going to detour him, you know, off of going for the 4 gold medals that he's going for.
Yeah, and we look at the 200 now, we'll move on. And I suppose a guy that I have a great time, I spoke to him in the past, and he's an expert in terms of staying about, and he's a guy for the big occasion. When the big lights, big occasion, big time sprinter, he seems to turn it on, he seems to come from nowhere, and he's a dangerous guy if he ever gets to a final, as André de Grasse, the Canadian sprinter for the 200 metres. And looking at André, I suppose people are saying, oh, is he past his prime? Is he elderly? Is he sort of in his last Olympics? But these sort of guys, they have a knack about in terms of the big occasion. So is it possible an André de Grasse in the 200 is very a dangerous opponent? He mightn't get the gold medal, but he could certainly take a silver or bronze off someone else.
Yeah, I agree. I believe he's not really a sleeper. You know, he doesn't talk as much as some of the other athletes, but I truly believe that, you know, it's possible for him to get a medal for sure. You know, like I said, again, he's with, I think, Coach Rainer as well. He has a great coach. His coach prepares his athletes for the championships, and I think that's the difference between a lot of other coaches. So I believe he'll be equipped and ready to run well, considering, you know, what he's been through.
Yeah, and just to finish up on the 200, just people are saying Leslie Toboko, an African sort of superstar in short running, maybe this Olympics might be just too early for him. The next Olympics, we might see he's rise upon it. But Kenny Bedarek is probably the guy they're saying in the 200 that is going to push Noah the most.
Yeah, Kenny has been looking very, very well. Real impressive. I was actually shocked. I didn't expect him to be beating Noah for 185 meters at the USA Trials. So he's definitely someone to look out for. Like I say, I think Noah's going to be super dominant. We'll see how his body holds up after he, you know, doubles, you know, this time, and kind of go from there. But I think Kenny is one of the favorites as well. Tobago, a lot of these guys, I mean, it's kind of wide open. You know, say Noah's the favorite, but all these guys have potential running very, very fast.
Yeah. And Tyson, I bring you on to the 400 now. And what a remarkable story it would be. And I suppose all athletics would put their hands up and applaud, given the tribulations and the horrific injury Matthew Hudson-Smith went through a year ago. And to be even back at Olympics is a phenomenal stage, and to be running the way he is in terms of what happened to him a year ago. But Quincy Hall is not going to give anything away easy in terms of that. He's trying to there to spoil the party. Then you have Stephen Gardner as well, a prominent pro. But Karani James is still a young athlete. People think he's knocking around the block for a time. Think, oh, Karani. But Karani's still in his 20s. And Karani James is like Andre Degrassi. He's all about the spotlight and the big occasion. And then Michael Norman as well. So maybe Matchin Hutchinson-Smith goes in at the favourite. But and maybe Quincy Hall will probably push him the most. But Stephen Gardner, Karani James, Michael Norman, can they turn it on and maybe upset the apple cart?
I think so, man. That's going to be one of the most exciting races besides the 100 meters. I truly believe the 400 is going to be possibly the what do they call it? The event of the Olympics, possibly. You know, I truly believe Matthew has came into his own. He's running phenomenal. As long as these guys stay healthy, I believe these guys are going to run 43 mid, I think. I don't think they're going to come close to the world record, but I think they'll run 43 mid. And I think we'll see some PRs from a lot of athletes in the 400.
Yeah. And before we bring it to the women, when we talk about some athletes go for into the Olympics and they're thinking about gold medals or podiums or getting to the final, other athletes then are in a different stratosphere and they're thinking about legacy. How our history will define me, how will I be remembered in terms of my legacy. And this is something that is at the doorstep now of Karsten Warholm, the Norwegian, in terms of the 400 hurdles. People know how phenomenal he is. People know of that he will go down in the history books. But it's all about cementing his legacy now. How great is he going to be remembered in terms of the 400-meter hurdles? And I suppose Ray Benjamin, Allison DeSantis, that's our podium, whatever way it finishes. But I saw Karsten Warholm race in the European Championships, and he just blew the field away. He just strode. He just cantered to success. It was just so easy for him. And he looks like there doesn't be a glinch in his armour. Is it possible that Ray Benjamin, Allison DeSantis could upset the Mr. Consistency, dare I say?
Yeah, definitely. Ra has been looking great this year. He's already, I want to say he beat him. I forgot which track meet. I think he beat him in Monaco, maybe. But I believe Ra is going to be the favorite. I think he's coming back for revenge. I think it's going to be a great race. Warholm is not going to give it up easy. But I really believe he's going to be pushed more than he's ever been pushed in his life. And I think if he pulls this off, this will definitely solidify his legacy. I mean, it's already solidified, but this will just put, you know, the icing on the cake.
And if Ray pushes him all the way in this, we could be possibly thinking of a world record here in the 400-meter hurdles. If Warholm gets the competition that he wants, and for Benjamin to beat Warholm, you think it's going to be something near a world record time if he's going to overtake him in terms of that. So this could be one of the fastest 400-meter hurdles we've ever seen in the Olympics.
Absolutely. And I'm going to say that he can get the world record also. You know, I don't know who's going to get it or if they're even going to break it, but I really truly believe that if they push each other, I think they're going to go to the finish line and just lay it all out on the line. And I think it's going to be very exciting.
Yeah. I suppose, Tyson, we've spoken about the men. I'm going to bring you across to the women now. And just we'll start with the 100 meters for women. And wow, if any of the heats of the Diamond League is to go by in terms of the 100 meters for women, 8.24, 8.25, 8.26. We're talking millimeters of the seconds between Shericka Richardson, Shericka Jackson, Julian Alfred. These ladies are pushing each other to great heights, and there is a nose of a whisker hair, dare I say, between them. And then you have Shelley Ann Fraser-Fryce. What can we say about that woman's legacy? She was there in 2012. She's there again in 2024. And there, who would foolishly write off Dina Asher-Smith as well, the British athlete? But the three youngsters, it's probably old versus young in terms of Shelley Ann Fraser-Fryce and Dina Asher-Smith, the old girls, and the young girls then, Shericka, Jackson, Richardson, and Alfred.
Yeah. Honestly, this field is wide open. You know, Shikari is looking great. The other girl, what's her name was? Alfred, what's her name?
Julian Alfred, yeah.
Yeah, see, I've been watching track and field some, but my first time watching her run was, I want to say last week, And I was super impressed. I was like, who is this girl? And then my friends started telling me, oh, there's da 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 da, keeping me posted up on all the new girls. But then again, I think Shelly is still going to come around and show that she's still, you know, a threat. You know, I think she's going to go out with a bang. I truly do. And Jackson, it's just too close to call. You know, I think it'll be a close race again. You know, they'll be dipping at the finish line. I think Mommy Rocky, I think if she hits her start one more good time, I think she definitely has a shot, you know, getting in the mix as well.
Yeah, I'll bring it on down to 200 meters for women. And there's a particular notice in this. We talk about certain athletes zoning in on one event in terms of, and the 200 meters for women, this is Gabrielle Thomas, Gabby Thomas. She's zoned in on this event. This is the only event that she's running in. She's not running in the 100. She's all her eggs in this basket. She's focused in on this. But we know then Shericka Jackson's here, Julian Afford is. But Dana Asher-Smith, well, however good she is in the 100, she's exceptional, as she's shown in history in terms of the 200 meters. That's her speciality, Dina Asher-Smith, in terms of the 200. But Gabby Thomas, having all her eggs in the one basket, going through, not having two competitions to juggle, does that give her an advantage, even though she's the favorite as well?
I believe it does. I truly do. I believe if you do the double, and if your competitor doesn't do the double, I believe it takes a little bit out of your legs when you run the 100, especially if you run fast. You know, it takes a little while for your leg to recover. I think Gabby could be the favorite just by only being able to lock in on one event. But then again, Shericka, she's a monster, man. You know, I can't put anything past her. I believe that girl has the potential to break the world record. I believe Gabby can run 21.5, 21, you know, low as well. So I think those two will go 1-2, in my opinion.
And I just want to skip the 400 meters for women because I want to leave that to the last. But I want to jump on to the hurdles, the women's hurdles, and then finish with the 400 meters for women, given the Irish aspect in terms of 400 meters for women. So in terms of the hurdles, we talk about legacy for Karsten Warholm. The same thing can be said about Sydney McLaughlin in terms of the 400 meters women's hurdle. It's all about legacy. She will go down the history books. She will go down as one of the best ever in terms of that. And people say if there's a safe bet for an Olympic gold medal, people are resting it on her shoulders as safe bet. But Finke Ball has been running good, Russell Clayton, but Sydney, dare I say, she doesn't seem to be slowing down any bit, dare I say.
No, I believe Sydney's going to win by a great margin. And I believe she will bring the other girls through a personal best. That's what I believe. But Sydney's in a world of her own. I've never seen nothing like this. I think she made her first Olympic team at 16, if I'm not mistaken. I can't remember. But I believe she's so dominant mentally. Like, she's so focused and locked in that I don't believe nothing can distract her. Like, Bo, she's running great. I believe she's going to run a phenomenal time. But I don't think it'll be enough to beat Sydney.
Yeah, and we're going to come across now to the 400 meters for women. There's great Irish interest in here. Competitive field, Nikisha Price, Jamaican, goes in as a favourite. But then we have Mardine Paulino, Natalia Kazmarak, and then the Irish athlete Rashida Akeleke training out in Texas there in USA. She's coming off a European Championships where she won the silver, but she helped the Irish team, the mixed team, to gold in the European Championships and the women's relay team to the final as well. And she was winning that 400 meters women in the European Championship all around to the last turn, but before the endurance effects. But she was very disgruntled, Tyson, in terms of being caught nipped on the line by Kasmarek. She almost like was raging with defeat that she got a silver medal in her first European Championships, that the running in terms of the relays and stuff like that took it out of her maybe the night before. But how what are the people in America talking about Rashida Akeleke? What's the sort of views in this girl running, representing Ireland, running out in Texas there? Do they value her? Do they think that she's an up-and-coming superstar?
Absolutely. You know, well, I mean, I have a small circle of people, and we talk about track and field, and I believe the sky's the limit for her. You know, I believe the U.S. athletes respect her. They know what she's capable of, and they always know she has a lot of heart. You know, so sometimes when you see someone who's upset and mad when they get second place, it just puts that fire in them and makes them come back even stronger. So I'm really looking forward to seeing what she's going to do.
Yeah, and in terms of this Olympics, it's on in Paris. The four women we mentioned there—they're all expected safely to come through and make the final in terms of that. But how you know in terms of running an Olympics in foreign soil, in terms of that, the crowd, the impact the crowd can make, and I suppose Ireland is only 2 hours of a flight to Paris, even less. And I suppose if Rashida gets to the final, she's going to have massive Irish support in the stands. It's almost going to feel like a home race for her, to all the Irish fans cheering on. And that's probably going to be like an extra person in her shoulder. Is that an advantage? Is that a motivation? Can that help you eke out an extra few seconds if you hear such a fan base roaring you on, where the other athletes mightn't have that, but Rashida will probably have that compared to the rest of them?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I couldn't have said it any better. She's basically going to have I don't know how many people, hundreds and thousands of little angels on her shoulders, you know what I'm saying, helping her get around the track. So that's going to be a huge benefit. Anytime you can feel the type of adrenaline from the crowd and run with it, it's a huge benefit. And I believe that's going to really help her get around that track.
Yeah. And I suppose in terms of the European Championships, can we sort of value much take out of the Irish team, the relay team? They won a gold medal in the mixed relay in terms of European Championships, but no Jamaicans, no USA national team there, obviously. Obviously, can you sort of gauge in terms of as a relay team how you're doing coming into Olympics if you're not going up against the Jamaicans or the USA? And but still, having a European Championship so close to Olympics and winning it like the Irish team did in terms of the gold medal in the mixed relay, is that so much prep and training? Is that like a year's training that maybe that can give them an advantage, maybe to get in a podium, dare I say, behind the Jamaicans and the USA?
I think so. I think they can get on the podium. One thing you have to understand is chemistry goes a long way. So even though you ran, or you may not have certain countries running against you, as long as you have the chemistry and and put the right team together, that's really all you need. You know, when you got four guys or to push it and have heart, and they all love each other and they all respect each other, that can go a long way, especially if you've already practiced and have the confidence.
Yeah, and I know you raced relay racing in your time at the Olympics as well, Tyson. And is that camaraderie, is that teamwork, having a team sort of event to go along with a singles event? Is it a plus? Is it a benefit? Does it help athletes relax before their own event to have a relay sort of event as well, that they can talk to their teammates? Takes the pressure off their own event rather than being in your own zone the whole time. Can it be a benefit sometimes to take away the pressure, to take away the stress, to be on a relay team?
Yes, I believe it goes both ways, because you have, if you do get to run a relay race before the games, you can run with your teammate, kind of see what leg you're going to run, see how everybody handles it. So that's a plus. But then you have your individual event, so you don't want to take too much away from it by practicing relay, practicing risk getting injured or something like that. So it's like a double-edged sword where you need to practice, but then if you have an individual event, it's tough because you have your individual coach, then you have the team relay coach, then you may have a little bit of button heads, because you know what I'm saying? So that happens as well. So it's like a double-edged sword, like I said, but it's definitely beneficial if you get to some races in and get the chemistry going.
Yeah. And I suppose finally, Tyson Gay, before I let you go, and thanks for giving that commentator breakdown in terms of all the things. How do you think this Paris Olympics is going to be remembered in terms of, we remembered Olympics past in the past, Rio was Bolt, 2000 it was Maurice Greene, we had Hessam Gelgarouge, long distance runner, David Rudisha was probably named in terms of London, in terms of what he did. Where do you think, in terms of track and field, people are going to be talking about it after 2024 and years to come, and say that was the Olympics of such and such a person, where they truly broke out, made a name for themselves, or they will be remembered in terms of legacy?
I think it's going to go one of two ways. I think it's going to go an American dominant Olympics in Paris, meaning, Noah Lyles does something great, like gets four gold medals, right? And then Sha'Carri does something, spectacular. And then the list goes on, and the hurdler breaks the world record, Or I believe it's going to be upset Olympics. Still great, still phenomenal times, but people who think are going to win are not going to win. So I think it's going to be a great Olympics, but I also think it's going to be some dark forces where we're not going to know what's going on because everybody's so close, you know what I mean? And all the times are really close with everybody. They're not just one dominant person right now. You know what I'm saying? So it's going to be tough, but I think it's overall going to still be a great Olympics.
Yeah. On that note, to finish, Tyson Gay, thanks for joining us this evening to share your views ahead of the Olympic Games track and field, which is kicking off next week in Paris. Tyson, the complete breakdown of the 100, 200, 400 meters and the hurdles for both men and women. All's left to say, Tyson, we really do hope that Rhodesia gets a medal here for us here in Ireland. And obviously the US track team does well as well. And hopefully you will enjoy the games. But for me, Jim Conlan, to you, Tyson, engaged. Stay safe, take care, and God bless.
Thank you. Thank you. Peace.
Take care, Tyson.